Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Mark Warner, and I'm the president of the Anesthesia Patient Safety Foundation. This afternoon, we're going to have a panel from the ASA members who are directors of the Anesthesia Patient Safety Foundation. The title of the panel is 10 Patient Safety Issues We've Learned from the COVID Pandemic. The goal of this panel is to highlight key patient safety lessons learned during the first months of the COVID pandemic. To do this, we've asked each of our APSF directors to provide the one important issue that made a major impression on each of them during the pandemic. Our panel format today is we've asked each director to spend 3 to 5 minutes presenting one of the most important patient safety lessons that they observed during the pandemic. There will be a pre-recorded question and answer period at the conclusion of these presentations. Our first speaker this afternoon will be Daniel J. Cole, Professor of Anesthesiology, the University of California, Los Angeles in Los Angeles, California. Dr. Cole will speak on the critical importance of developing national guidelines.
Well, thank you, Mark, for the invitation to speak to you today about the critical importance of developing national guidelines. And I'd like to focus on one of the first guidelines or statements that APSF made on personal protective equipment. First, nothing to disclose is regarding conflicts. Jump right into March, in which the pandemic really hit. We started to get little inklings of what was going on several months earlier. But this is one statement that is out in the public domain, one of many that I heard about both personally and in public and social media. Essentially, anesthesiologists, physicians, healthcare workers did not have adequate personal protective equipment when taking care of either COVID-19 patients or patients at risk of COVID during aerosolizing procedures. The important key here is the very bottom quote, not only can I not protect myself, or we had an interest in the healthcare workers, but also the many patients that each infected asymptomatic healthcare worker might infect regarding their patients. Some key facts. First, in March of this year, we had known community spread, which made containment strategies very challenging and made it unknown how many cases there really were in the community. A lot of patients were asymptomatic. It is known that patients can be asymptomatic, but contagious and highly contagious just a few days before developing symptoms. And there are many patients that have COVID-19 that do not have symptoms at all, but indeed are viral shedders. The testing for SARS-CoV-2, the virus that causes COVID-19, had a lot of variability regarding sensitivity and specificity. At one point, I counted over 40 different tests in the market that were approved by emergency use authorization. The infectivity was quite high and the mortality was quite high when referenced to the flu. And transmission was known to occur by direct contact, indirect contact, large droplets, and it was very plausible that aerosols also transmit SARS-CoV-2, like other viruses. One of the big indications in the media was the Washington Inquirer event in which a super spreader infected 52 people at a choir practice. A real quick primer on aerosol dynamics. When someone coughs, sneezes, or causes an aerosol, such as what we do when we intubate, extubate, etc., the largest droplets rapidly settle within 1 to 2 meters from the person. But there are smaller particles, aerosols, that are trapped in the turbulent puff cloud and remain suspended and can travel 6 to 8 meters. The inoculum depends on the source control, or controlling the source of the virus, a good hygiene, the proximity of you and me to the source, the duration of our exposure, airflow within the space which in we reside, and protective measures, which was the address of our first statement. This statement was put out March 19, 2020, and essentially put out in jointly by the ASA, the AANA, and the APSF. When anesthesia professionals will be at increased risk of exposure, such as caring for patients with diagnosed COVID-19 infection, and or when aerosolation of body fluids may occur, N95 masks or PAPRs provide the highest level of protection. And this has been borne out as a very valid statement, a very valid recommendation. Recent data suggests that the filtration efficiency of N95s for very small particles is at 98.5%, surgical masks with ties about 72%, and surgical masks with loops about 38%. I thank you for your time and attention.
Thank you, Dr. Cole. Our second speaker is Matthew B. Weinger, Professor of Anesthesiology, Biomedical Informatics, and Medical Education at Vanderbilt University in Nashville, Tennessee. Dr. Weinger will speak on staff safety and burnout risk.
Good afternoon. I'm going to speak about clinician safety in the COVID era and some of the things we've done at Vanderbilt University Medical Center. Before COVID, about 45% of anesthesiologists reported symptoms of burnout. We do not yet know the real effects of COVID on anesthesiologists' well-being, but many of the factors known to contribute to burnout appear to be more prevalent during COVID. Since resuming elective surgery, many of us are working more hours, are under more pressure to get cases done, and see patients who have delayed needed surgery for months who are presenting in worse condition. For many of us, the clinical and work environment appears to have degraded. There are greater concerns for our own safety. We have issues with access to resources and supplies for the new needs. For those who must care for COVID patients, there are new clinical duties and expectations, new rules and protocols, and our overall sense of community seems to have eroded, in part because of the personal protective gear and the fact we can't shake hands, we can't eat and socialize together, and when we're not clinical, we're working remotely. Our organizations are under greater financial pressure, and some have seen significant cuts in pay and income. And at home, our families are under greater pressures, and that leads to work-life conflicts, a known contributor to burnout. Starting in early March in our department, we surveyed and conducted interviews to understand the impact of COVID on clinician and staff well-being. We found substantial increases in stress and anxiety in all of our stakeholder groups. And many clinicians, particularly our intensivists, reported feeling more burned out. We realized that we needed to provide new and more resources to support our clinicians and staff, both professionally and in their personal lives. By late March, we had created a faculty and staff support team. This team is led by a faculty member, Amanda Stone, who's a clinical psychologist, and includes all of the relevant stakeholders. This is from our website, shows all of the members of the team, and you can see that it includes clinical faculty, basic science faculty, residents, nurse anesthetists, pain and perioperative nurse practitioners, anesthesia technicians, perioperative nurses, administrative staff, and research staff. Early on, we conducted a number of focus groups and listening sessions, and subsequently we've had a wide range of support sessions and virtual happy hours on many topics. Each week we push resources to the department primarily through our weekly newsletter, and we have a website that we've created called Take What You Need, where anyone in the department can contribute potentially useful items, which are then reviewed by the team and curated by two professional writers who are on the team. This is the website. You can see that it has a variety of categories to identify specific types of resources. The connection category right here is primarily for peer support and other types of support sessions. The calm category has mindfulness, relaxation, and breathing exercises, as well as online class access. Services is primarily childcare and counseling, but has other resources. And the other categories are gratitude, laughter, music, activity, which is physical activity, including online classes, nutrition, and sleep. This is in the connection category, which is password protected. Faculty or staff can click on colleague connection, which gives them access to individual peer support as well as group sessions. And the other item seen on this website is a session that has been put on by Amanda Stone and Catherine Clark on parenting in the COVID era, and includes a variety of topics relevant to that. Overall, our department's employees have found these efforts helpful, and I hope you do too. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Weinger. Our third speaker today is Jeffrey M. Feldman, professor of anesthesiology at the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Dr. Feldman will speak on the safety implications of using anesthesia machines outside the operating room as ventilators.
Greetings. My name is Jeff Feldman, and I chair the APSF Committee on Technology. I'll be speaking to you today about the safety implications of using anesthesia machines as ICU ventilators. Early on in the pandemic, there were great concerns about the supplies of ICU ventilators. Reports from Italy were not reassuring. On March 18th, the New England Journal of Medicine published an article, and they stated that there simply were not enough ventilators for all patients who needed them in Italy, despite a highly advanced medical care system. So it was clear that our primary objective in developing a response in this country was to try to ensure that no patient would die for lack of a ventilator. There were a number of options that were investigated and continued to be investigated, but it was clear that the most readily available supply of ICU of ventilators would be anesthesia machines that could be used to care for these patients. The decrease in elective surgery would help to the supply of machines, and in general, modern anesthesia ventilators are highly capable. On March 24th, the FDA issued an emergency use authorization, which removed the regulatory barrier to using anesthesia machines for this purpose. Yeah, ICU ventilator, from a user perspective, is a fairly simple device. You set the FiO2, you select the ventilation mode and settings, and you hit go. The anesthesia machine, on the other hand, fresh gas flow must be selected. There's a circle system which allows return of exhaled gases. CO2 absorbent is present. The delivered oxygen concentration in the fresh gas flow can be different from the inspired oxygen concentration that the patient experiences. There's the ability to deliver inhaled anesthetic agents. There's a scavenging system and a daily power-up self-test. In addition, the anesthesia device is designed to be monitored by a bedside clinician who can respond locally to the alarms and displays. So while we were concerned that no patient would die for lack of a ventilator, there was also a concern that a patient would die because of the ventilator. So there are a number of safety-related questions that need to be addressed in deciding how to purpose the anesthesia machines in this fashion. Where to set the total fresh gas flow, how to manage the CO2 absorbent, should we use anesthetic agent for ICU sedation, where do we connect the scavenging system, how often should a power-up self-test be performed, how should the machine be monitored and controlled. The initial recommendation for fresh gas flow was to use low fresh gas flows, in part because there were concerns that the supply of oxygen would become inadequate. Low flows would conserve oxygen, humidity, and anesthetic agent if it was needed for sedation. Of course, CO2 absorbent would need to be managed. Early on, we learned that low flows did not work. 10 liters per minute or more was required. to prevent rapid exhaustion of absorbent and excessive humidity from accumulating in the circuit and clogging breathing filters. In addition to the use recommendations for the anesthesia machine as an ICU ventilator, a quick reference guide was published in conjunction with the anesthesia machine manufacturers that provided recommendations for monitoring the machine over every 24-hour period. While these recommendations were rational, they were difficult to comply with, particularly in those locations that were overwhelmed with patients. Many patients were housed in individual patient rooms that were repurposed as ICU rooms. Typically there were networked physiologic monitoring, but typically not networked anesthesia machines, so that the machine could be either viewed or controlled from a remote location. I want to take a moment to commend the numerous anesthesia professionals who became just-in-time intensivists and managed these machines and patients in conjunction with the ICU colleagues and saved countless lives during that time. In summary, anesthesia machine ventilators have provided life-saving support to numerous patients during the pandemic. There are not a lot of reports of patient injury as of yet. There is one report from Mount Sinai that's in the ICE anesthesia, the APSF website, that's of interest. There was not a patient injury thanks to the diligence of the care providers. And anesthesia professionals have played a key role in safely deploying the machines as ICU ventilators. If we are going to use them in this fashion, methods for remote display and control of the machine will be needed in the future. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Feldman. Our fourth speaker today is Stephen B. Greenberg, clinical professor of anesthesiology at the University of Chicago in Chicago, Illinois. Dr. Greenberg will present on introducing multidisciplinary providers into the ICU setting.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Stephen Greenberg, and I'm the editor-in-chief of the Anesthesia Patient Safety Foundation newsletter, Vice Chair of Education in the Department of Anesthesiology at North Shore University Health System, and clinical professor at the University of Chicago in the Department of Anesthesiology. And I'm delighted to be here today to talk to you about the COVID pandemic silver lining. And in my opinion, it truly was and is multidisciplinary unity. My disclosure is that I'm editor-in-chief of the APSF newsletter. Now, the projection for COVID-19 pandemic was that approximately 30% of the U.S. population would test positive for COVID-19. About 5 million would likely need hospitalization, about 2 million would need ICU care, and a little less than 1 million would require ventilatory support. Yet, 48% of the U.S. hospitals have no intensivists. There really are only 28,000 United States intensivists and 34,000 U.S. advanced practice providers available to the ICU. Now, a few months ago, about 5,000 ICU providers were surveyed regarding their concerns about the COVID-19 pandemic. And over 58% of the surveyed ICU providers reported that they were very concerned about ICU staffing shortages. Some strategies to meet the staffing surge capacity are that retirees were invited to rejoin the workforce. State-based licensing requirements had been relaxed to allow medical professionals to cross state lines. Hospitals developed same-day credentialing and privileging. States expanded their scope of practice to allow clinicians of various disciplines to work independently. Trainees with non-critical care medical education were permitted to work in the critical care environment. And medical schools advanced their graduation dates to help the physician workforce. Now, the Society of Critical Care Medicine developed a tiered staffing strategy for pandemics. And they broke it down into three tier provider models. Tier one was providers that were trained or experienced in critical care, usually physicians. Tier two providers were ICU advanced practice providers or non-ICU physicians that had some past critical care training. And tier three providers were non-ICU physicians or advanced practice providers. And you can see on the left side of the screen that the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center sort of identified how many patients that each tiered provider could actually manage during a pandemic. And we use the similar model at our institution. And you can see that as capacity is
pushed, and the amount of patients are required to be taken care of increases, the morbidity and incident demands rise dramatically. Now at North Shore, we had 33% of our anesthesiologists and 75% of our nurse anesthetists provide clinical care in the ICU. As an anesthesiologist intensivist, we work with pulmonary critical care to provide workflow and duties to non-ICU attending physicians. And that really included developing an anesthesiology run, proning team, line, and airway team. We also developed a goals of care team that standardized the way we approach end-of-life care and a multidisciplinary, multi-professional approach. We also developed a management strategy team to standardize the care that we delivered to our COVID-19 patients. CRNAs, PACU nurses, ER nurses buddied up with the ICU nurses for tutorials on how to use order sets, documentation, and care pathways. And our fantastic critical care advanced practice providers provided key lectures on key critical care topics to the non-critical care APPs. Now here is our staffing model that we used at North Shore University Health Systems. And it really was based on the Society of Critical Care Medicine's staffing model. But here you can see we used intensivists, residents, nocturnists, trauma surgeons, critical care nurse practitioners, PAs, non-critical care NPs, CRNAs, and anesthesiologists to provide critical care for COVID-19 patients. And as we increased our census, we needed to increase this multidisciplinary provider approach. Now, here are some reference tools that we used for non-ICU provider education. These were absolutely important in improving the effectiveness and efficient workflow that we developed so that we could educate the non-ICU critical care providers. I want to thank our incredible multidisciplinary, multi-professional provider team for the excellent care that they've delivered in the last 7 to 8 months. And really, for the time that I've been at Evanston Hospital. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Greenberg. Our fifth speaker today is Stephen K. Howard, staff anesthesiologist at the VA Palo Alto Healthcare System and professor of anesthesiology, perioperative, and pain medicine at Stanford School of Medicine in Palo Alto, California. Dr. Howard will speak on how to utilize simulation for training healthcare providers to care for COVID-19 patients.
Hello, my name is Steve Howard. I am a staff anesthesiologist at the VA Palo Alto Medical Center and a professor of anesthesiology, perioperative, and pain medicine at Stanford University School of Medicine. Today, I'm going to tell you how our group used simulation to train healthcare providers to treat COVID-19 patients. Simulation has always been used as a lever to change. When we see a problem that can be addressed with simulation, we quickly put our heads together to create curricula essentially on the fly and perform rapid cycle testing to build tools and curricula that we then use for training. In February of this year, as we learned more about SARS-CoV-2 and the disease it caused, our anesthesia group became very concerned how this disease would alter our clinical practice and even become a serious threat to caregivers. In late February, the VA Palo Alto retrofitted one of its hospital wards to house COVID-19 veterans, the first such ward in the United States. There was a large degree of uncertainty as to how many patients we might receive, but we were forced into quick action because on March 2nd, our first COVID-19 patient, who had been a passenger on board the Diamond Princess cruise ship, was transferred to this new ward. Prior to this, two of our junior faculty, Carlos Brun and Jody Ling, took on the challenge of preparing our anesthesia group using simulation, and this is really their story. Initially, the most concerning issue for our group, and probably for every other anesthesia professional, was how could we protect ourselves while caring for COVID-19 patients? We were being inundated with horror stories from China, Italy, and then New York City, and these visions escalated our concern. Doctors Brun and Ling decided to focus their efforts on developing the correct level of PPE, and then to quickly train our anesthesia group in the donning and doffing protocols thereof. Early on, viral transmission routes were not clear. Was transmission via droplet, aerosol, or a combination? So we opted to train to a higher level of enhanced PPE, similar to what had been published for the Ebola virus, with the thought that we could always alter the level of PPE after we understood more about the viral modes of transmission. Our simulation experts set up the simulation center to mimic the VA's COVID-19 ward, allowing clinicians to practice the skill of donning PPE, caring for a simulated patient requiring airway management, and then carefully doffing the contaminated materials. Given that this was a departure from the usual workflow, the providers that participated in this learning were very motivated to quickly get up to speed. In many cases, the learners became the teachers as we truly put the see one, do one, teach one methodology into practice. Staff and resident anesthesiologists were trained, as was our large staff of respiratory therapists. The simulation space was shared with VA Palo Alto's nursing service to allow us to maximize the number of trained clinicians. Finally, many lessons were learned, all of which will continue to be useful for this and future pandemics. Perhaps most importantly, this training increased our confidence in caring for these challenging patients as we embarked on this journey together.
Thank you, Dr. Howard. Our sixth speaker today is Megan Lane Fall, an associate professor in anesthesiology and critical care and epidemiology at the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Dr. Lane Fall will speak on managing information overload.
Hi, my name is Megan Lane Fall, and it's my pleasure to join you for this panel. My topic is managing information overload. I don't have any financial conflicts of interest to declare. I have the dubious distinction of being the disaster preparedness officer for my department at Penn. Prior to 2020, that mostly meant preparing for mass casualty incidents, but then COVID came, and we noted that there was a near continuous stream of information, some of it good, some of it not so good, related to the care of patients with COVID. There was so much information that someone coined the term infodemic to describe it, where an infodemic is an excessive amount of information concerning a problem such that the solution is made more difficult. We had information coming at us in many different formats, including social media, personal contacts, the lay press, and scientific publications. I want to share with you three lessons that we learned in managing information that helped us in the course of caring for patients in the pandemic. The first lesson is that we had to help our team by pre-processing information. We chose content experts who could process the vast amount of information in their area of expertise, distill down that information in usable formats so that we could then provide it to our clinicians at the bedside. One way of distilling down that information is to create infographics. Here we've given an example of how we took the Anesthesia Patient Safety Foundation and American Society of Anesthesiologists guidance on using anesthesia machines as ventilators, and we worked with a graphic designer to create a visually appealing cognitive aid that could decrease the cognitive burden of processing the information and really allow clinicians to have this information at their fingertips. The second lesson is that we had to provide a reliable source of information. The APSF is really useful here. As early as February 2020, the APSF was publishing guidance on how to safely intubate patients with known or suspected coronavirus infection. Since that time, the resources available on the APSF website have grown, and there's a novel coronavirus anesthesia resource center that's available to people around the world interested in caring for these patients. The ASA has also been important in this regard, creating a clearinghouse of information about COVID-19 for anesthesiologists and hosting a series of town halls focused on the care of these patients. This has been particularly helpful for those of us who are seeing patients that we may not have seen since our training. We did something similar at Penn where we created a learning homepage, distilling down information for people who were unfamiliar with the care of intensive care unit patients, and this resource is available publicly. The third lesson we learned is that we need to communicate often, daily, sometimes more often than daily if needed. The purpose of this frequent communication is to manage anxiety and uncertainty, to create transparency, and to create a shared sense of purpose. The types of topics that we covered in these daily communications were the availability of PPE, resources for dealing and coping with stress, updates to rapidly shifting clinical expectations, and key contacts for questions. So those are the three lessons. It's been my pleasure to speak with you, and I look forward to the question and answer period. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Lane Paul. Our seventh speaker is Della M. Lynn, clinical professor at the John A. Burns School of Medicine, Department of Surgery in Honolulu, Hawaii. Dr. Lynn will speak on psychological safety with patients adapting to COVID.
And the vision that was planted in my brain still remains within the sound of silence.
These lyrics from The Sound of Silence describe what's not psychological safety. My name is Dr. Della Lynn. I practice in Honolulu, Hawaii, and it is a pleasure and an honor to be on this panel. Lack of psychological safety emphasizes the asymmetry between voice and silence. When someone, anyone on a team, feels that they might be punished, humiliated, labeled as annoying, disruptive, even stupid, for speaking up with questions, concerns, and ideas. A culture of psychological safety informs us on how status is handled. As just one of many examples in the literature, Amy Edmondson's work in NICU teams, where they found that teams that handled status by flattening the hierarchy had an 18% lower mortality rate. In the workplace, I sometimes define psychological safety as not having to put the workplace face on. And you know, it's not just about speaking up. It's about listening, and it's about humble leadership. In the next 3 minutes, let's consider psychological safety with the patient being part of the team. Why is this important? How does COVID impact it? And what can we do about it? So why? In September of 2019, APSF held its Stolting Conference on Failure to Rescue. The Human-Centered Design Conference gleaned 9 insights and challenges. 2 of those challenges: create a culture that values all voices equally, empower providers to deconstruct hierarchy and catalyze action. One of the finalists named their prototype Empower Flower, and their solution stresses the concept of putting the patient in the center. How does COVID impact psychological safety? A couple of months ago, one of our outreach teams in Hawaii conducted a community survey. What are you concerned about now and in the next 3 months? Well, health is certainly in this list, but the word cloud shares many other things that are in the forefront of our patients' minds. Their brains, our brains, and lives are hijacked with a myriad of issues that are distracting us from the usual focus of, I'm going to be your anesthesiologist and you are my patient. COVID workflow disruptions also impact psychological safety. For example, wearing masks distance ourselves from each other and the patient. No visitor policies limit family participation and their ability to be part of that radar of early warning signals. Limited number of patient room entries and closed doors hide informal clues. They dissuade informal conversations that we might have with our patients and their families. And staff are exhausted. They too have their brains hijacked with anxiety, sleeplessness, fatigue. I asked one of our anesthesiologist colleagues who spent 34 days on a ventilator as a COVID patient, how would you fill the following sentence? While in the hospital, I wish. His response, know me as a person, know my story, understand my life, not just a diagnosis in the bed. So what can we do? 2 important messages in nurturing psychological safety. 1, admit vulnerability. We don't individually have all the answers. And 2, don't worry alone. Ask for help. With my patients, I've been trying to offer video anesthetic consultations preoperatively since COVID. It gives my patients a chance to see me without my mask, and it allows me to emphasize with the patient, don't worry alone. Although I tell them the call is going to cover the usuals, you know, medications, anesthetic history, anesthetic plan, I tell them we will conclude with what questions he or she might have for me. And then I tell them I'm going to start with the end in mind. We're going to begin the conversation also with what questions do you have for me? Because I don't want to end this call forgetting something that's important that's on your mind. I share changes due to COVID, including the fact that COVID can be distracting. And I open up about our own vulnerability and give them permission to say what's on their mind. And I thank them. I thank them for sharing a part of their life with me. Because whether we take this call at their workplace or at their home, the video is sharing a part of their life which was previously hidden to me. The Sound of Silence lyrics go on to say, "No one dared disturb the Sound of Silence." As anesthesiologists, let's dare and be the bridge for our patients. Let's flatten the hierarchy, the asymmetry of voice and silence, the asymmetry exacerbated by COVID, the asymmetry that threatens patient safety. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Lin. Our eighth speaker is May C.M. Pian Smith, Associate Professor of Anesthesiology, Harvard University, in Boston, Massachusetts. Dr. Pian Smith will address Circle Up, a briefing and debriefing model to rapidly disseminate learning and enact changes in practice.
Hello, everyone. I'm May Pian Smith. I'm on the board of directors of APSF, and I'm chief of quality and safety for the Department of Anesthesia at MGH, Harvard Medical School. Today, I'll be talking about Circle Up. It's a briefing and debriefing model to rapidly disseminate learning and enact changes in practice. These have really been extraordinary, unusual times for all of us. And personally, I've never been more proud to be an anesthesia provider, to be on the front lines, not only taking care of patients as best as we can, but thinking outside the box, navigating workflow and system changes, and in the midst of all this, taking care of each other too. In the next few minutes, I'm going to share with you a framework for coordinating communication and care that was developed at my institution by my colleagues, Chris Rusin, Mary Fay, and Jenny Rudolph at the Center for Medical Simulation. I was so fortunate to be the beneficiary of this approach when taking care of patients at the peak of the surge in Boston. And I invite you to think about how this type of system might be helpful for you and your institution. In particular, the system helped us bolster staff performance, psychological safety, and resilience, especially as they relate to our working at the edges of our comfort zones. Whether it was using machines and devices in new novel ways, or redeploying workers to unfamiliar areas with new tasks and unfamiliar team members, we had a lot of learning and flexing and pivoting to do in a short period of time. So to address these challenges, we borrowed from well-established simulation-based techniques, such as debriefing and deliberate practice, and from techniques based in process improvement science, such as rapid cycle PDSA techniques. Circle Up is all about sustaining and supporting psychological health as well as excellence and quality of care. I'm going to talk you through this complicated slide. First, as shown in the middle of the circle here, Circle Up has three main objectives: helping teams to be adaptive, realizing that it's how we adapt during challenges that affects our outcomes; helping our staff to be resilient via connection and support; and ultimately bringing our best to our mission, which is to keep our patients safe, every patient, every day. Now looking at the outside of the circle, Circle Up has again three important components. The three primary activities are, from left to right, briefing huddles, then peer check-ins, then debriefing huddles. So first, team debriefings at the beginning of a shift or procedure are to establish and optimize a work plan. The idea is to promote clarity and purpose of action and introduce and encourage questions and concerns. People are introduced, team roles are clarified, there are updates on processes and protocols. Where appropriate, there can be mental rehearsals of new routines, Plans to check in on each other can be reinforced, and people can be invited to debrief at the end of the day too. Then peer check-ins. During the course of the day, there are informal interventions to connect and support. Colleagues are encouraged to recognize and appreciate contributions and listen and offer support. And finally, at the end of the day, debriefings provide a positive framework for sharing developments that have happened. Colleagues can reflect on successes and challenges, and they can explore root causes, and they can initiate or report on adaptations and solutions that have happened. They can answer the question, what do we need, and offer uplifting summaries and action plans. So moving from shift to shift, dynamic teams are thus able to grow, adapt, innovate, and improve in a cyclic, iterative way. So again, I'm pleased to be able to describe this system that works so well for us and to encourage you all to imagine how such a system can support your own important work at your own institutions. We can do it together. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pan Smith. Our ninth speaker is Richard C. Prelip, Professor of Anesthesiology at the University of Minnesota in Minneapolis, Minnesota. Dr. Prelip will address Rush to Judgment, Publication in the SARS-CoV-2 Era.
Hello, it's Richard Prelip, professor at the Department of Anesthesiology at the University of Minnesota and executive section editor for patient safety of the journal Anesthesia and Analgesia. We're going to take a few minutes to chat about publication in the COVID era and the question, has there been a rush to judgment? Communication has obviously changed. 160 years ago, it was a remarkable achievement to get a half-ounce letter from New York City to San Francisco in the span of only 10 days, relying on the Pony Express for the majority of that transmission. Today, in 2020, we obviously have instantaneous, global, low-cost electronic communication noted by over 5.2 billion unique mobile phone users scattered around the world. In late February and early March, editors of major publications solicited articles from thought leaders and content experts to accelerate the publication of critical COVID information to clinicians and readers. You undoubtedly have seen publications, as noted here, where the Word document format was used, usually with a watermark noted accepted in order to indicate it had undergone official journal review. Submitted articles were fast-tracked and published online ahead of print with immediate free access. The process proved remarkably effective. As you can see here, in the early months of the pandemic, February, March, and April, there was virtually an exponential rise in publication with almost an arms race to get COVID information published ahead of print. This process has continued successful, with a recent PubMed search indicating over 55,000 articles now published and noted with these search terms. But with such speed and acceleration comes the possibility of misinformation. Here's an example. In early March, a letter to the editor published in Lancet first raised the question about antihypertensive medications affecting the expression of the ACE2 receptor. Almost parenthetically, the author noted that ACE2 receptors could also be increased by drugs like ibuprofen. Within a few days, the French Minister of Health tweeted that the public should avoid NSAIDs. Within a day after that, the information was picked up and added to the official French health bulletin reporting serious adverse events related to NSAIDs have been reported in patients with COVID-19. This was unsubstantiated, but the misinformation was picked up and distributed worldwide by the lay press within a matter of a few days. It's not just the lay press which is vulnerable. Indeed, here we see two very prestigious journals, both of which have retracted full published manuscripts in June of this year related to COVID information, which could not be substantiated. This is both from the New England Journal and Lancet. So what are readers and clinicians to conclude? Well, beware. The pandemic has markedly increased the pressure to publish in both the medical and lay press formats. Editors are striving to maintain the highest standards of review and vetting of scientific publication. One challenge is that many content experts, the ideal reviewers for this information, are essentially unavailable due to overwhelming clinical demands during the pandemic. Authors must also be cautious about how isolated statements may be taken out of context and spun in the Twitter universe. And ultimately, clinicians and readers should look and be extra cautious about publications labeled opinion or rapid review, especially those which may contain sensationalistic titles. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Prela. Our 10th speaker today is Marjorie P. Stiegler, Associate Professor of Anesthesiology, University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. Dr. Stiegler will address, is our do more with less mindset a threat to safety culture?
Hi, I'm Marjorie Stiegler. I'm an adjunct associate professor at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. I'm a member of the board of directors for the Anesthesia Patient Safety Foundation. For the next few minutes, I'd like to talk about the do more with less mindset and whether this itself is a threat to safety culture. I don't have to tell you that ingenuity is the hallmark of anesthesiology as a profession. We are creative problem solvers. It's what we do. It's why no one in this audience is likely surprised to read headlines like these and to discover that the physicians in these stories are anesthesiologists. We have a tremendous amount of creativity, flexibility, and adaptability. We can do just about anything in any environment, with any level of resource, despite considerable complexity. We rise to the challenge and get it done. That's our calling card. It's said that necessity is the mother of invention. And with the COVID pandemic, there have been many, many new needs and therefore many new inventions, or at least a lot of innovative thinking about how to meet these challenges. And obviously under pandemic situations, there's a very strong feeling of urgency to rise to the occasion and find a way to provide care despite less than ideal circumstances. We've also seen a lot of innovation and creative thinking around personal protective equipment. Here's an example. And they say, this is not an FDA-approved device, but we believe it's better than a trash bag, a bandana, or nothing. This device is essentially a combination of an N95 mask and a full face shield, or at least that's their intent. So this is very laudable, it's creative, but as they've noted, it is unproven. We're also seeing now widespread adoption of these so-called intubation boxes. And these are being made by a variety of companies, all with slightly different configurations and capabilities. How does the clinician extract themselves from this box after the intubation is successful? How do they do so without contaminating the environment? And what if the organization which they work uses these boxes in lieu of sufficient standard personal protective equipment? Does that give a false sense of security? Certainly you've seen pictures like this all over the media. On the left-hand side, there are nurses who are putting trash bags on for some barrier protection. And on the right-hand side, an emergency room doctor who has set up a decontamination zone in her own home. It raises the question, is there no systemic responsibility for rising to that standard of care? And when we think about whether it's better than nothing, that seems to be echoing around personal protective equipment quite a bit. There are considerable gaps in the literature on the efficacy of reprocessing PPE, and this is largely due to the fact that PPE are manufactured for an intended single use. So there's small studies or simulations suggesting that the functionality can be compromised with some of this equipment without any physical signs of wear or tear or deterioration. Today, a lot of healthcare professionals will tell you that they, quote, have PPE. But what they really mean is that they have a few masks on a rotation and that for the most part, they wear the same PPE all day. And this is really a far cry from the intended single encounter use. So it's worth remembering why we even have doffing processes in the first place. As a standard, all PPE is considered contaminated after being worn. Many experts feel that the correct doffing is actually the most important part of infection transmission prevention. So given that, how do we interpret this new standard of wearing the same PPE all day? Is this really the best way to serve patients? I think we know it is not. Is it the best way to keep ourselves safe? And is it the best way to keep our healthcare teams safe, knowing that if some critical number of us are ill, that puts an additional burden on the rest of the team and possibly compromises our collective ability to continue to care for patients? So in thinking about all of this, we have to ask ourselves, where does innovation stop and normalization of deviance begin? Now, if you don't know that phrase, normalization of deviance, this was coined during the description of the terrible tragedy of the Challenger space shuttle explosion in 1986. It's defined as the gradual process through which unacceptable practice or standards become acceptable. And as the deviant behavior is repeated without catastrophic results, it becomes the social norm for the organization. The social norm for the organization, in other words, the safety culture. We don't have the ideal state to take care of patients with everything that we need, but we do have patients who need us. So we do our best under the circumstances, but we also must remember we bear some responsibility for what we continue to accommodate. Despite their limitations, new ideas and devices that have not demonstrated sufficient efficacy or safety are being embraced and being embraced very quickly. I urge you to embrace them with caution because we are establishing new cultural norms with every passing day. And if we are not careful, our do more with less MacGyver type mindset may end up itself being one of the biggest threats to patient safety culture.
Thank you, panelists, for an outstanding set of presentations. We will conclude today's panel with questions and answers. These questions have been previously submitted and responses are pre-recorded. The first question goes to Dr. Lin. Can you give me more specifics on what you tell patients about COVID during your video pre-anesthetic consultations?
Thanks for the question, Mark. I tell them what we are doing differently due to COVID and try to walk them through what to expect and to build their trust. So some of the things I talk about are universal temperature screening for all staff, visitor policy and the why behind them, expectation that they're going to be wearing a mask through transitions when they're not in the OR but moving from one phase to the next. And sometimes I go over OR surgical site infection prevention measures. They seem to enjoy learning about the additional two viral filters that we put on the anesthesia circuit. And also I cover why the PCR antigen test is not just to protect us from a potential COVID positive patient, but to protect them because of the increased morbidity of having surgery when COVID positive. But most of all, just to establish a dialogue and get the dialogue going. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Lin. The second question goes to Dr. Pian Smith. Most of us are used to handovers, either intraoperatively or at shift changes. Can you talk more about the middle piece, the peer check-ins? What is the best way to do that and not make people feel awkward or defensive? Is there a format or template to make that conversation easier?
Yes, so definitely the conversation may depend a lot on the situation and also your relationship with the other person. I try to make the conversation easier by thinking of it in four parts. So first there's the opening, then there's the talking about challenges. Third, I want to highlight bright spots. And fourth, I want to offer peer support. So going through those four things, the opening could include something, you know, very natural, like, hi, how are you doing? Things have been really hard and I wonder if you want to talk for a minute. That's, you know, the icebreaker. And then talking and sharing challenges could include, so what have the challenges been for you today and what has helped? And then, of course, we want to have a positive spin on things. So identifying bright spots could be as simple as, what have the bright spots been and what have the successes been today? Were there any unexpected wins? And then finally, offering support can be as simple as, gosh, what can I do for you right now? Or is it okay if I follow up and check in on you later? And so, of course, also I would say that as with all difficult conversations, the more we practice, the easier these become. And eventually you get to the point where you can just lead with empathy for the person and you don't have to feel very awkward or very rigid about sticking to a script. And really at the end of the day, no matter how you say it, the fact that you reach out to someone during difficult times is what's most meaningful. So definitely worth giving it a try.
Thank you so much, Dr. Pian Smith. The third and final question goes to Dr. Howard. We don't have a simulator, and I don't know how to do simulation. Can you give me some advice?
Thank you for the question. Not everybody has simulators. Not everybody has people that have expertise in utilizing simulation. But I've always found that simulation is a great excuse to get people together just to talk. We talk all the time at work, but you know, oftentimes it's about the work and we don't actually get into the nuts and bolts of why we do the things that we do and what's important for us and our little tribe. I would be willing to bet that you actually already do certain forms of simulation, like role play. Role playing a difficult conversation with a junior learner, that's simulation. Doing what if kinds of questions. What if the patient developed bronchospasm right now? How would you treat that and how would you diagnose that? I think these mental simulations are a great place to start, and that's what I would suggest.
Ladies and gentlemen, in summary, the pandemic and its impact has been very personal, as you've seen that 10 directors of the APSF have all had unique perspectives on important lessons from the pandemic. Each of our presenters have provided insights into an issue they found to be profound and important to patient safety during the pandemic. I'd like to thank them, and I'd like to thank you, and also provide you with an opportunity. Please consider supporting our mission at APSF, that no one shall be harmed by anesthesia care, and make a donation. The donation can be in your name, a donation to honor a friend or a colleague, or a donation to memorialize a mentor. To learn more about giving to APSF, please visit our website at apsf.org/donate.